So open doors part two this morning. It's such a heavy topic, and often trying to prepare for something like this, you want to put like three sessions or day sessions into a 45-minute sermon, and it's not always possible to do this. So I'm not going to tell you everything this morning. I'm not saying that I know everything, but I've been around the block with a few of the challenges that we faced in my own personal life as well. So I'm going to try and bring a picture to you this morning that will give a bit of context as to what we are talking about. So for those of you that weren't here last week, we're going to do a quick recap. So let me just ask, who was a bit more conscious and aware of closing and locking up their doors this week? Amen. All right. So in the natural, last night the alarm was on and my wife was like, did we lock the front door? I was like, oh, let me go check. I run out and it wasn't locked. So that awareness is that's why we talk about these things, because it's awareness. If I start talking about, and it's often, it happens when we start speaking about things of the demonic, things of, when we talk about judgment, when we talk about hell, when we talk about sin, that's often the topics that we want to, that we avoid, because we want to have the good sermon or the good feel good feeling on a Sunday morning or during the week, because we don't want to actually deal with the things that can hinder us from a full relationship in Christ, because it's scary to think about it. So last week we just slightly shared on as an introduction on open doors and what it means and how does it look like in my life. And we said that in Ephesians 6 verse 12, the key is we don't fight in the natural. We don't fight physical bodies or physical people, but we do fight principalities and powers, authorities and rulers, unseen or from a cosmic power, as the word says. It's over this present darkness against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And we know that it's difficult to fight something that we cannot see. Will you agree? So if we can't fight something that we cannot see, the challenge is, or the problem is, that often we avoid it because we don't know. Or because we don't know, or we weren't aware of it, we just like carry on as if nothing is happening. And then you're like, but I'm struggling with breakthrough and I'm struggling with certain things. And the thing is, if we avoid conversations like this because of fear, that's often what happens, is because we speak about demonic things or spiritual influences in our lives. So I'm going to use the word demonic. I'm going to use the word influences in our lives this morning. And I want you to understand that we do not have to fear any of this. And you'll see why. You'll see why it's not anything that we have to fear. But sometimes we are unable to speak about this or address this because of the fear in our lives, because of the fear of the unknown. So we avoid it and we become ignorant and think, ah, it's okay, I'll deal with it at a later stage. And then, unfortunately, what happens is it hinders us from having a life that we flourish in Christ. Because that is what God calls us to. A flourishing life in Him, in His salvation, in who He is for us. So, can a Christian have a demon or a demonic influence? And the answer is yes. And the reason is, we are not possessed, as Christians, we are not possessed by demonic influence, but we are oppressed. And there's a very big difference, because the Greek word, which last week I couldn't pronounce and I still can't pronounce it, is the word daimonizomai. Okay, just go and look it up. It can be translated as demonized or has a demon, which implies there's an influence of demonic nature on certain areas of a person's life. Okay, so we need to understand that. And sometimes it's incorrectly translated as possessed. But the Greek meaning specifically behind this is oppression. Okay, so possess means I give authority over this, for this influence over my life, and they have full power, full authority. That's possession. But we are not possessed. When we are in Christ, He possesses us. That's what He bought when He paid on the cross for us. He bought our freedom, and that's why He can possess us. So He can do with us. But it's still from our place where we need to, come to Him. All right. So the thing is, when you buy a house, you possess the house. And then the house is also possessed by termites, little insects that eat inside the wood. And as I said to somebody this week, when you look, you don't see a termite from the beginning. You don't see it as you walk in. But at some point, there's a hole in a part of the wood, and you're like, but where did this come from? And then you see another hole, and then another hole. And at some point, when you start knocking, it's hollow inside, and you're like, but why? Stop. As you open it up, there's these little channels that's been formed by termites. So the thing is, you can either leave it, and it's going to destroy the house, or you can deal with it as you enter. So it remains an important part. Jesus gave his disciples the command to share the gospel and to drive out demons. That was His commandment in Mark 3:15. So Christians can have a demon that entered them before their conversion. But they can also, through a habitual sin or a sinful life, there is open doors that we create. And we're going to look at that today in that. So we have two categories. You have the generational things, pre your conversion, things you've done, and then the post conversion, where there's things that you do in your life that wrongful choices and so on. So it clarifies just that some of us might have an oppression of a demon in our lives, or demonic influence or spiritual influences that hinders us from flourishing in a full life in Christ. And that's the beautiful thing. Jesus came to set us free. Okay, so he paid the price, and He had the victory on the cross already for us. Now we need to deal with the termites. We need to deal with the things that are in this house. And He defeated the enemy, and He declared that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That is going to happen whether you believe it or not. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. From us who are sitting here, straight through to the spiritual realm of influence, demonic influence, the spirit of darkness, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is the ultimate authority. So the devil is constantly scheming. Peter talks about stay alert, be aware. Okay? He's like he's like a roaring lion, and he's scheming against believers. So that's what we've got to be aware of. So this week when we talked about it, I just realized, but sure, this roaring lion looks from the outside like a very dangerous. But when he opens his mouth, he's got no teeth. Okay, so he's got a gums gooey. It's like running on the rims. So it's important to understand the powers of the power that the enemy has over us, and what we are, how we see it. That plays a massive role. So over the past few weeks, we've had a few visitors, and one of the things that really stood out is that God is busy doing something new in our congregation. So for those of you that are visiting today or here for the first time, and God is really busy doing a new thing, and he's given us words of new wine and new wineskins over the past 2 years already. So in order for a new wine in new wineskins, there's going to be a bit of change and there's a bit of cleaning out to do. So I believe there's an opportunity for us a month in advance, because Swakop has got four seasons in one day. So you can choose which one you want now. So I'm choosing spring cleaning and spring to happen a month in advance. So we have spring cleaning that we can do in the next month, in a season to come, so that God can come and do something new in our congregation and continue to do that. But he's nudging at the door. He's knocking on our hearts. He's pulling our sleeves and saying, come on, guys, let's be serious and pay attention to what is going on in our houses. All right? You agree with me? And the thing is, we're going to ask, the three things that I want to highlight from last week is, number one, we need to understand that the demonic or the spiritual world is real. It is there. God speaks about it. Paul reiterates it in Ephesians 6, where he says that, for we do not fight. We fight powers and principalities of this darkness, of bodies unseen. So it's a reality. Whether you believe it or not, it is a reality. The second thing is, we are a temple. We are a temple and we are God's dwelling place. And we need to look after that. And 2 Corinthians 6 verse 16 says that he's made us his temple. He chose us as a dwelling place. It's a choice that God made for towards us. And number three is, the key is, a temple cannot have trespassers for they interfere with worshiping God. So last week's scripture was in Matthew 21, where we talked about the cleansing of the temple, where Jesus came in and there was a marketplace, in a sense, happening, and that hindered people from worshiping God. So what is the marketplace being set up in your life today that hinders you from fully worshiping God? Is it anxiety? Is it anger? Are you carrying an offense, intimidation, fear, rejection, unworthiness? Are you irritated with things around you? Are you feeling depressed with no purpose in life? Nothing you do feels like it makes a difference. But maybe you're happy and there's areas of your life that's hindering you, or you feel, but listen, I'm in this area, I'm running into a ceiling, I'm running into a wall. I just don't know how to get through this. Maybe it's time to take a look at what's going on in the house. Allow the Holy Spirit to reveal those areas of oppression that we need to deal with. So Jesus wants to set us free, and I think it's definitely time to take a closer look at our temples and what's going on inside our hearts. And what is Jesus busy with in your life? What is it that he's speaking to you about? What are the areas that you are struggling with at the moment where you need that freedom? So this morning I want to talk about the authority of Christ and the authority that demons have in our life, or demonic influences have in our life. And I want to talk about the different groupings so that you are aware of which areas they can challenge us. And then ultimately, Christ's victory, Jesus's victory, what does that mean for you and me? Okay, so let's dig into that and see how it is. Because the thing is, when we talk about open doors, when we try and compile a list of areas and things that are wrong in our lives, we can do an A to Z list and it's going to be endless. It's going to be so long, we're going to be here the whole day and your chicken is going to burn in the oven. Because that's how long the list is. That's how things are progressing. Because the enemy is a legalist. And he will come at all angles to try and manipulate, to lie, to deceive, to bring division so that you will agree with that lie and give him power and authority in your life. And sometimes we do it knowingly or unknowingly. So my introduction to freedom counseling or demonic or deliverance, if we want to call it like that, was done in 2018. And I remember when Peter and Tani Leentron, they came to visit us, and we had this course with them for 3 days where we sat and we listened. And I was just like, listen, I want to be part of that. because now I know I'm born again, and there are things in my life that I want to deal with. They were highlighted, and I was like, Lord, I want to clear this, but I also want to be part of this ministry. I immediately felt drawn by it. That was like, whew, I get excited. And maybe it was in the beginning because of the let's call it the action of Danielian's stories that that drew me, because I'm not always a person who likes the more one tone, just keep things steady. I love it when there's action in my life. I love it when we can joyfully celebrate things and we can be loud and all of this. So I'm like, in my household, I'm the palm tree of things. So I'm the loud one. I'm the one that makes the jokes. I'm the one that will take the challenges, do the risks, whatever there is to do. I will do it. That's me. So my wife has the privilege of sometimes when I'm opening up the wings or the palm tree is slightly wide, she can just cover and find cover and don't have to say too much. So that's my typical personality of doing life. You know, I want to do life to the fullest. And when I got introduced to this ministry and I wanted to go and I surrender and give my life to this to get free from any and all oppression that is in my life, I went to the session with Peter. I think I sat with Tew, one of the other counselors that they brought with. So when I walk in, I was like, he looked at me and says, what did you bring here? I'm like, man, I've got the camera, I've got the little spit bucket or whatever there is, I've got tissues, I've got water. I just bought the whole army pack, because we're going to deal with these things today. Whatever there is, we're going to let them out. And I know from my life, from my personality, the manifestations, shall we say it, how they're going to come out, how they're going to be cast out, it's going to be wild. So you better lock the door. You must make sure that, listen up, make sure that, that I don't escape. Okay, so I want to deal with these things. So that was my heart. It was a complete surrender of saying, I want to deal with this. So I went in, and Dew said to me, listen, start speaking. Tell me your story. Tell me a bit about your life. Man, and it wasn't about 2 minutes, and I was already crying. I was like, oh. All the things that you have done, and you start feeling guilty, and you start feeling condemned, and you feel ashamed, and you're like, And he just continued to calm me down and listen with a careful ear. And 2.5 or 3 hours later, session was over. No camera. No circus. No nothing. Because the gentleness of the Holy Spirit just came over me in that moment. And it highlighted the areas that I needed to renounce. It highlighted the areas that I need to deal with. I could bring it into the light. And I was able to be set free through the cross, the finished work of Jesus on the cross. And that was the most beautiful part. You see, the thing is, sometimes we expect, when we talk about demonic influences, we want it, or we think that it is, man, we've got to be afraid. And that's the thing. That's what the demonic brings into our lives. It brings fear, and it hinders us from addressing the things because of fear, because of darkness, because of the shame, the guilt, the condemnation that you carry because of the things you've done. So we walk with this. We carry it in our hearts, and we don't deal with it. We avoid it. We say, oh no, I'm just gonna keep it in the back door. And we keep that door locked because we feel so ashamed of dealing with it. And that's the beauty of going to a freedom counseling session. There's that space of trust and safety that you can share your heart. And that's how I felt it. And the Holy Spirit just created that atmosphere there. His presence was so tangible that it gave me hope for the future. It gave me hope, and it brought to realization that I do not need to fear any of these things. But I must be aware. There's a very big difference to being afraid than to be aware. So on that day, the Holy Spirit had these beautiful plans and revealed beautiful things in my life. And when I look back today, I'm like, I can continuously celebrate. Because the moment that I stepped into that, that freedom was like a catapult for the next season of my life. Did I get everything right? Absolutely not. Do I still get everything right every time? Absolutely not. I run into walls every single day. But how do you deal with it? How do you overcome? How do you get through that? Because it's a decision. It's a thing that we've got to do in our life. We've got to draw near to God, and He draws near to us. And in and through that, we resist the works of the devil, and he will flee. James 4:7. Draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. And God says, come. And then he gives you that power, that powerful weapon of resist the devil, and you will flee from him because of who we are in Christ. Okay, so let's talk about the entry points a bit of and give you some context as to what I spoke about. So the number one thing is we need to understand is our authority, influence, the spiritual influences, their authority, and Jesus' authority in my life. Okay, so number one is demons have no authority unless it is given to them. That's very important. They only work on authority. They are legalists, and when given authority will remain there until such a time when that authority is revoked and they have to leave. And it cannot be revoked unless you say that you want to revoke it. Unless you say that you want to renounce it. Because otherwise you give them legal access. You give them that legal right. And how does it work? So they are unwanted tenants who have no regard for your well-being and will destroy your house, because that's their mission: to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's what they want to do in your life. All right, so the only authority that they do recognize, and when they move, is by the authority of Jesus Christ. And listen to this passage in Acts 19, verse 13 to 16. It says, a group of Jews was traveling from town to town, casting out evil spirits. And they tried to use the name of the Lord in the incantation, saying, I command you in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, to come out. Seven sons of Sceva, a leading priest, were doing this. But one time, when they tried it, the evil spirit replied, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are you? Then the man with the evil spirit leaped on them, overpowered them, and attacked them with such violence that they fled from the house naked and battered. Demons acknowledge the authority of Jesus Christ. And they did it in this instance before Jesus is actually... this was after... Jesus has already paid the price on the cross. He overcame the cross. The victory on the cross was done. So people went around, because in Ephesus, the occultic nature and practices, that was the center of the occultic or the demonic things happening, magic, black magic, and people went around making loads and loads of money. I think in the one study Bible, or the ESV study Bible, it says that if you translate that into today's terms, they would make roughly about $120 a day from the books, from the healing, from the things that they would do in various names, because what they would do is they would use a list of names from all the deities to cover, to make sure that they cover every, if this person believes this, if this person believes this, then at least they have sort of a matter of authority to speak because they use that name. So they would recollect all of that, and they would sort of issue it on paper or book, or in a book form, and they would sell it. So it from what they made, it was roughly about $120 a day, and translated into a month, it's close to like $1 billion worth of money that they make. So can you see how they manipulate, try to manipulate the situation? But then they walked into a wall. Because I'm using this scripture to illustrate to you that this is an area of our life that we do not play around with. When you try and make fun of this, or you try and use this as to boast your own ability, you're going to get a hiding. And I'm not saying it to create fear this morning. I'm saying it to create the reality and to illustrate the reality of the demonic world out there. And if you're doing it from your own capacity, from who you are, and not by the authority and the love and the comfort and the protection of Christ, you're going to be in trouble. You are going to be in trouble. So they acknowledge, these demons acknowledge the authority of Christ. So demons have a right to oppress us when we give them authority or legal access. And the devil is a legalist, and he may only oppress us through the open door of legal right, which is sin. So let me give you a few examples. If you look at pornography, if you look at pornography, that is sin. That opens the door to lust, sexual impurity, and a whole lot of other things that can come into your life. Okay? Let's say my dad told me that I'm useless and I will never achieve anything in life. Let's say he speaks that over me. And I want to speak it as I'm specifically mentioning it so that we as parents can listen to what we say. Because if I speak something, or my dad spoke that over me, I believe the lie of the uselessness and not becoming anything in life. If I believe that lie, the enemy has legal right, because it's not the truth. It's not God's word. It's not the truth of who God created me. So if I believe the lie of the enemy, and that's how they come in, that's the door, that's an open door. They make you believe the lie. So what is the outcome of that? If they start oppressing me, that can lead to rejection. Who have you felt rejected in your life? Yeah? Self-pity. Bitterness, depression, guilt, shame, and in most cases, even suicide. This is reality. This is things that I do not make up, but they are, it's a reality because I've seen it. I've seen how these influences bring people down. Another thing, And there's many more examples, but I just want to mention one or two of these things. Your parents have struggled in business, and you've gone through challenge. They've gone through challenge after challenge after challenge. And now you are in business because you're trying to make the best of it. You've given your life to Christ, but you continue to struggle. You don't make means end. Deal after deal is failing. Things are not working out. That can be a generational thing a generational curse that is carried over. Because a blessing is carried over into a thousand generations. But a curse into the third and the fourth generation. So just from my life, in my life, alcoholism was a problem. My dad and four of his brothers passed away because they were alcoholists. Well, yeah. Alcoholics, donkey, really, sure. Alcoholics. That's five men from one family. Five men. So in 2016, I had to make the choice to say, but am I going to allow this to carry on? And I said, no more. And I drew a line. And I renounced that spirit over me. And I stepped out of it. And to this day, which is 6 years later, I still don't drink. And it's not a debate this morning whether you can drink alcohol or not. For me, it was a generational thing. What is it for you? It probably wouldn't have affected me in the same way it did my dad, but my kids would have been affected because there's a generation that continues. If it doesn't come right with the first generation, it'll take the second one. If it doesn't come right with that one, it'll take the third one. And that's how it continues until you break or you go through that generational cleansing where you cut off the bloodlines and do these things. Okay, we need to move on. So there's many more. I can tell you a lot of stories. Maybe let me just mention this one. Because it will give an indication of the reality of what we are facing. So in this one session where I sat with a person, so we understand that the demonic is a real thing. The demonic influence is a real thing. When they speak, if you think of the man that was set free by Jesus as he approached before he came to Galilee, there was a man that was possessed by a demon, and he ran around in the graveyard, and as he came, he said to Jesus, "What do you want to do with me, Son of Man?" Before the time, so demons have the ability to speak, and what happens is, or the demonic influence, these spirits, they speak. So what do they do? Is they Jesus or the Holy Spirit allows your human spirit to rest, to stand back. And that exposes often in a session, exposes because it's a controlled environment. The control, God is a God of control. So in a session like that, we make sure and we ask the Holy Spirit to make sure there's control. Nothing is out of order. There's order and the main authority is Jesus Christ. So in this particular session, so we need to understand that demons do speak. So in this session, I sat with this person and we were going through a few things and it's as if we don't get breakthrough. And at some point we both sat opposite each other because you sit close, I sat close to the person. And in many of the case, or in this specific case, we were like almost at our last end. It's like, okay, I just don't know anymore what to think. I cannot hear. And the Holy Spirit revealed something to this guy sitting in front of me. He said to him, "You made a pact with the devil at some stage. You said to him, you will give something of your life," and he didn't even physically do it in a occultic scene. He just said, I'll give my life for this if this works out. I'll do this and this if this works out. You see, that's agreements with the enemy. So in this case, he made a pact. He made an agreement with the enemy. And when he mentioned it, he went quiet. His facial expression just turned upside down. And he started looking at me and he spoke with his deep voice. and he looks me in the eye. Now you've got two choices in that. You need to understand who you are as a counselor. You need to make sure that you understand your authority in that place. So as he was speaking to me, the aim was to intimidate and to bring fear, because that's what they do. If they are in a corner, if this influence needs to go out, it's a strong man or whatever, or a gatekeeper, they will really try and intimidate you or bring fear upon you. Okay, so I'm sitting there, and he says to me this, he says to me, "You doubt your authority in this place." I said to him, "No, I don't. We need to understand." So now I'm having conversation, because now I get to the story behind the story of why this thing is there. And if I said to him, if you try to sow doubt, and the moment that I said to him, "I do not doubt what is happening here. I do carry the authority of Christ." Mark 3:15 says, "Go and share the gospel and cast out demons." Jesus gave us that authority. So as I was sitting there, I knew who I was in Christ. And I was like, "Lord, this is the moment where you come and deal with this thing." And I said to him, "So you know you can't do anything to me?" He says, "Yes, I can't do anything to you. But I can mess this guy up." So he's talking about this person himself. And I said to him, "Well, you can't do anything, because I bound your hands and your feet and everything." And he was just sitting there. He's like, he's absolutely, he cannot do anything because of the authority of Jesus Christ. And when I told him to leave, when I commanded him to leave, because you need to give them a clear command. You tell them, you renounce that lie, you renounce the deal that he made, and you say to him, "Go." So I renounced and I commanded him to leave. And he went out with this bang, and he wanted to shout and scream and everything. But when that guy woke up or came to his right mind, his senses again, he was free. He was free. And it's difficult to sometimes explain it, because it's a complete change of posture to the person in front of you. And that's why I say we deal with this. This is a reality. And if we take it lightly, we're going to be in deep trouble. So this portion of scripture that I want to continue or try and end off with is Matthew 17, verse 18 to 20. "Then Jesus rebuked the demon in the boy, and it left him. From that moment, the boy was well. And afterward, the disciples asked Jesus privately, 'Why couldn't we cast out that demon?' They said to him, 'You don't have enough faith.' And Jesus told him, 'I tell you the truth, if you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, "Move from here to there," and it would move, and nothing would be impossible." So here we see a portion of scripture that says Jesus rebuked the demon. This father went to Jesus's disciples, and nothing they did could hinder this demon to come out. So some of the translation says through fasting and praying only. In this specific one, the New Living Translation, he says by faith. You didn't have enough faith. So faith is a crucial thing when it comes to freedom counseling, to our freedom in Christ. Is without faith in Jesus, we're going to be constantly oppressed by the things of this world. We're going to be overcome by that. And our faith in Christ is pivotal. It's like the foundation for everything that we do. Because if we truly believe in the finished work of the cross, we would be able to move spiritual mountains and oppressions in our lives. But only through believing in the finished work and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. In ourselves, we have nothing to give, but in Christ, we can say, "Be gone in the name of Jesus. Be healed in the name of Jesus." and it will be done. And they will leave. So authority is crucial in our understanding and dealing with the enemy. And as Ephesians says, Paul uses the word authorities and rulers, which means there is a legal or a ruling capacity that takes hold. And secondly, there's an authority. So the only way to fight authority is to fight it with a higher authority. And that you do with Jesus Christ and through Jesus Christ. So that's the key to our weapon. So let me just quickly run through a few groupings or a few open doors that might challenge you, might have an influence on you. So the number one thing is, I think in this world today, is our sexuality. All right, so there we talk about ungodly soul ties, sex out of marriage, molestation, rape, lust, etc. There's a whole list of things that can be an open door for you in your life. If we talk about addictions is the next thing that the enemy tries to steal, kill, and destroy from us. Drugs, alcohol abuse, social media, pornography, stealing, lying. There's more to come. And then there's occultic practices. So for instance, if you believe in spirit guides or even as much as reading hand palms. Just in this week, I was made aware of, many years ago, I think I was 16 or 18 or something, a lady read my hand palm. And she said things that were very accurate in that time, and I had to renounce that. I had to rebuke that, or renounce that, revoke that agreement on my life. Because God is the author and finisher of my salvation, Jesus Christ. So it's when we are made aware of it, there's keys, there's tools of how to deal with them, because they do not have authority over us. So demonic games, movies, music, those are part of occultic practices where they can have access. Relations. Rejection, neglect, manipulation, unforgiveness, bitterness, and the list goes on. Those are areas of open doors. Those are areas where the enemy, if you agree with any of that, that they will enter. And they will oppress you. Again, I'm not saying possession, eh? Okay? Not possession. You are not possessed. But you are oppressed. All right. And then death via suicide. Trauma, when you about somebody close to you that died, or somebody that you were close to when they died, nightmares, abortions. These are all areas of influence, all areas of open doors. If you receive constant nightmares, it's something to come and talk to us about, or your accountability partner. False religion, when you enter into Satanism, ancestral worship, New Age, Freemasonry, anything that believe anything other than Jesus. And our salvation in Him and through Him can be an open door. So if you allowed yourself to be part of anything like that, it's definitely worth a talk. And then obviously identity, which we have spoken about the last few weeks, unworthiness, guilt, shame, rejection, self-hate, rebellion, pride, victim mentality, poverty. So there's and the list goes on. This is just, I cannot give a full list. We don't have enough time. And we're going to have to finish up. So some of the things mentioned here is done by ourselves, and others are because of a door that my dad, my mom, or my great-grandfather left open. Freemasonry, for instance. If your great-grandfather was part of the Freemasons, there's a very good chance that in and through your life, you will carry the same spirit. And that's like a false religion. That's something that will hinder you from full belief, the full faith that we have in Christ. Okay, so that's important to take note of these things. With any and all of these forms of oppression, open doors, we need to understand that they are from the darkness. They are not from the light. Rulers and authorities, they want to steal, kill, and destroy. And they only want to, and the only way to deal with them is to expose them to the light. Because where the light is, darkness cannot remain. And that's why we need the radiant light of Jesus Christ and His salvation for us. And that's the last point where I'm going to end off now. It says the powers These powers operate in hiding, and they are deceivers. So they will make you believe that you are okay. They will make you believe that you don't have a problem. And please hear my heart this morning. I'm not saying that we are all oppressed and we all have problems. If you've dealt with them in the past, if you've dealt with them through this journey of freedom in Christ, and you've gone through, for instance, deliverance session or inner healing, then it remains important to understand that this is a continuous journey. So we don't just do it once and then it's dealt with. But it's a continuous journey. What we do here today, or what we spoke about last week, today, this week to come, is the beginning if you haven't embarked on that journey. But you need to understand that from here on, this journey is going to continue. And you cannot stop. And in order to embark on this journey, we need to have the right tools in our toolbox. We all have that tool, but we need to understand how to use it. So if we don't expose these things in our life, if we don't bring them into the light, the problem is they will remain in hiding and they will continue to oppress us and influence us. And mostly it happens through our emotions, through our mind, through the area that fluctuate. When the things in your life is irrational, impulsive, or compulsive of nature, then we need to take heed and we need to address them. So when we think about demons and the influence they can have on us, the ever-present fear of day of life, we empower the enemy and draw away from the Lord when we constantly are drawn into this mindset of demonic. And that's why I want to create awareness this morning. It's important for us to not be so fixed on it that it draws you away from your relationship in Christ. And the thing is, if we don't understand what Jesus did for us, if we don't live from that place, these thoughts will consume us. We will be constantly living in fear because of this, and we don't have to. Let's read John 1 John, and I just want to read 1 John 5 from verse 4. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Everyone say our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? And ending off with John 8:36. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Jesus came to save us because of the Father's love for us. And He chose us to be His dwelling place, and we have the privilege to spend eternity with Him. All because He loves us. So open doors in our lives need to be shut. Open doors in our lives need to be dealt with, and we need to draw that line in the sand and say, Lord, no more. I want to deal with these things in my life. Jesus made a way for you and me to overcome the schemes of the enemy. And that is our faith in Him. Can you stand with me, please? So I had a song in my heart this morning that I just wanted to share. And I want us to listen to it. And then I want us to take a bit of time to do business with the Lord this morning. If there's an area of your life where you feel that you need to deal with, now is the time. And let's open it up this morning. Let's open our hearts this morning. And I'm going to ask all my leaders, all the leaders in church, those who've gone, even if you've gone through deliverance before, and just to come in, to be ready in the front to minister to people. Okay, so it's not going to be a show off or anything like that this morning. But I do trust that God will come and bring healing in areas of your life and set you free from things that is hindering you from a fullness in Him, a flourishing life in Christ. He loves you dearly. He loves you more than you can ever comprehend. And because of that, He wants to set you free. So let's use that, that song, please, Aaron John.
Thank you.